Madam Deputy Chairman, I rise to support the bill which has been moved by the Honorable Minister to state in the Ministry of Home Affairs. This bill incorporates certain sentiments which the country holds so dear as far as the Office of President is concerned, and also incorporates the faith of the people in themselves that when they will elect a president, the person who would be occupying the high post would be a person who would have not only the love and affection of the people, but would be, as the Honorable Minister pointed out, a dedicated politician whose whole life is dedicated to the service of the nation. Before he became the president, during his occupation of the office of president, and even after he retired from that office, it is this confidence of the people in themselves and the high love and affection which they hold for this office which have resulted in this particular bill being considered by the House at the present moment. The Honorable Minister has pointed out that the President, who has just retired, has fulfilled all the requirements which are the basic of this particular measure, and the measure which was passed in 2001. I wish that he had mentioned the last Governor General also, to whom both the measures apply. Whether we may agree or may not agree with the last Governor General on some of the political views that he holds, there can be no two opinions that the last Governor General was also an illustrious son, and is an illustrious son of this country, and deserves all the consideration, all the love and all respect of the country which are being incorporated in the present measure and were incorporated in the 2001 Act. While therefore fully supporting the measure which is now before the House, I would like certain clarifications regarding the rules that are going to be made for giving effect to the provisions which have been incorporated in the present bill. In the statement of objects and reasons, we are told that a person holding a high office of president has, even after retirement, many public calls on him, and it is therefore considered desirable to provide him with secretarial staff. It is further stated that the bill provides for a staff which may be engaged for the president. Staff might be appointed for him, and office space might be provided for him. It is because of this that certain misgivings have arisen in the minds of some of the members, and they want it to be made perfectly clear that the staff will be appointed not only for the ex-president, but will be appointed by the ex-president, and it will be his wishes and his desires that will be taken into account when a particular person is being appointed. Also, regarding the office which is engaged for him, his wishes should be taken into account so that he knows what would be a convenient place for him, and he may try to get that place. Another reason for insisting on what I consider to be an important detail is that if the government appoints the staff for the ex-president, then they become government servants because they have been appointed by the government. It may be that in the rules a clarification might be attempted whereby they may be exempted from some of the service conduct rules which are applicable to normal government servants. But even there, it will be much better that this should not be left in any doubt and that these persons that are appointed to assist the ex-president in his secretarial staff are appointed by the ex-president himself. They would be the staff of the ex-president and would not be appointed by the government for the ex-president and would not be government servants. This point ought to be made quite clear so that the ex-president has got all the right of determining the service conditions of the people appointed by him. Of course, subject to the overall limit which has been provided and to my mind rightly provided in the bill. Within that overall limit, perhaps it will be much better to leave the rest of the matter to the president himself so that we may also express our further confidence in the president to the effect that he would utilize it with discretion and with all sense of responsibilities and fair play and taking into account the interest of the public and of the public exchequer too. Another point which also needs some clarification is regarding the payment to be made for the secretarial assistance and for the secretarial staff. Normally, government rules require that whenever any such demand is made on the public exchequer or on the Consolidated Fund of India, a certain formality has to be gone through and that formality of accounting has to be in a prescribed form